بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وبعد. As we are having the Aqidah class today, inshallah, we're going to talk about something that is very much important for Muslims to believe in. This is one of the articles of faith. As we talked last time about, last couple of times we were just giving an introduction and we talked about the very first of these articles, which is to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is explained in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is also called in the hadith of Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked by him about the meaning of Islam, the meaning of Iman, the meaning of Ihsan, and some other questions related to the Day of Judgment, the signs of the Day of Judgment, the hour, and some other points. Last time we talked about the categories of Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as this is the very first article of faith in Islam, to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and tu'min billah. And I think we do not need to repeat these things again, but just shortly we said that there is Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, Tawheed al-Asma' al-Sifat, to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as the only creator, to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as the only God, to believe in the attributes and the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the details that we have discussed last couple of times. Another important article of faith is to believe in the angels that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had created way before human beings. They had been there before human beings. And this is proved by the ayah in the Quran, Surah Al-Baqarah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking the angels to prostrate for Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, when he was first created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً قَالُوا أَتَجْعَلُ فِيهَا مَنْ يُفْسِدُ فِيهَا وَيَسْفِكُ الدِّمَاءِ. So, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in this kind of dialogue between him subhanahu wa ta'ala and the angels, here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling them that he is going to make vicegerent Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth. And they started talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those kind of creatures are gonna, you know, just spoil on earth, they are gonna do corruption on earth. And later on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked them to prostrate to Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, and they did, except Shaitan of course, and he was cursed because of that. And you know, this is something which subhanAllah, yani, this just comes to your mind. Shaitan is just punished and tortured by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he is cursed just because of disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only one time. Allah asked him to make the prostration to Adam alayhi salam, and he said, no, I'm not gonna make the prostration for a creature, you know, that had been made of mud, while I am created from fire. And according to his understanding, fire is more superior than the mud. That's why he didn't want to make the prostration to Adam alayhi salam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cursed him and kicked him out of the Jannah just because of one time he disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What about all of us human beings, and we are disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all the time? So we're just hoping for Allah's mercy and forgiveness. So you know, the story keeps going until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, talk to Adam that this is gonna be your enemy and you need to guard yourself, your families, your, you know, disciplines against its plot, because it's definitely gonna work hard in order to make you to astray, to get you astray, to make you to displease Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And again, this is mentioned in the Quran in so many places, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ فَاتَّخِذُوهُ عَدُوًا. Shaitan is your enemy, so regard Shaitan as your enemy. Just consider it as your enemy, and do not just blindly follow the whatever the Shaitan is telling you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know the story, I don't want to go into the story because this is beyond the scope or the theme of the talk today. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again, because this is a very important point, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had this kind of dialogue with the Shaitan, and the Shaitan just promised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that just give me a chance and I'll show you that I will be having the influence, I'll be having the effect. I'm gonna, you know, just make people astray. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you are gonna make people to go astray, except إِلَّا عِبَادَ. Shaitan even said, إِلَّا عِبَادَكَ مِنْهُمُ الْمُخْلَصِينَ. Ya Allah, I will be doing that to the weak people, the people who are having this kind of weak commitment to you, the weak commitment to your religion. إِلَّا عِبَادَكَ مِنْهُمُ الْمُخْلَصِينَ, except for the sincere servants amongst your servants. I'm not going to be able to, you know, influence them in whatever negative way. So this is the kind of dialogue, and the point is that we really need to take the shaitan as adu, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in the Quran. Whatever, the shaitan is just coming and insinuating us. Whatever the shaitan is tempting us, this is definitely for, you know, the bad relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is the promise that he had given to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again told him, إِنَّ عِبَادِي لَيْسَ لَكَ عَلَيْهِمْ سُلْطَانِ, you will be having no control at all to my sincere people, to my sincere servants. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us all from those that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala meant in the إِنَّ عِبَادِي لَيْسَ لَكَ عَلَيْهِمْ سُلْطَانِ. So again, coming back to the angels. The angels are, as we have defined them in the introduction of this class, the angels are defined by Muslim scholars as those creatures who have been created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala out of light. It is different, you know, way of creating. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created human beings from the mud, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created, as we said, way before He subhanahu wa ta'ala created human beings, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the angels from light. So this is the definition of them. They are created from light, and they are just there in order to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to praise Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are doing nothing except whatever is pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is mentioned in Surah Tahrim, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in the end of one of the ayahs in which He is asking us to guard ourselves against the fire, وَلَيَعَزُ بِاللَّهِ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ قُوْ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قُوْ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةُ. The people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing people, believers, saying, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قُوْ أَنفُسَكُمْ, guard yourself against the hellfire, the fuel of which is قُوْ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةُ. The fuel of this fire is people and the stones, the idols that people use to worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or instead of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah is talking to us about this fire. عَلَيْهَا مَلَائِكَةٌ غِلَاظٌ شِدَادٌ لَا يَعْصُونَ اللَّهَ مَا أَمَرَهُمْ وَيَفْعَلُونَ مَا يُؤْمَرُونَ. This fire is just, you know, guarded. It is just run by very, you know, huge-bodied angels. And they are never disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are just obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they are doing whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just asking them to. So the very reason for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have created the angels is just to worship Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, to glorify Him, to praise Him. And this is mentioned in the Quran. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about the angels, He said, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, يُسَبِّحُونَ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارَ لَا يَفْطُرُونَ. They are just glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala day and night. And they never feel tired of doing that. This is the task for which they have been created. And some of them are worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praying. Some of them are worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala standing. Standing, when we are praying, we are standing. Some of them are just bowing down to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some are just prostrating to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some are making tasbih to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So each group of the angels have been there with the task or the way specified for them to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with. And this is again mentioned in the ayah, يُسَبِّحُونَ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارَ لَا يَفْتُرُونَ. They never get tired of doing that, because this is why they have been created for. So when it comes to, again, to the angels, they are not, you know, they are not a kind of mediator between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and between human beings. And this is one of the misconceptions some non-Muslims do have when it comes to understanding the angels. They are not mediating between us and between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? As we said last time, we do not need to have mediator between us and between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you want to contact Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you can just go ahead and contact Him directly. You do not need to have any kind of mediator between you and between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِي إِذَا دَعَانِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, today in the after Fajr, I was talking about the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, dhikr. Subhanallah, and this is one of the very beautiful ways to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to make dhikr to Allah. Because when you are praying, you are not praying all the time. You are not praying 24 hours. Right? I might be praying and I'm saying assalamu alaikum, assalamu alaikum, and I'm taking a pose and then standing again. So this pose, so this is not prayer, right? So but when the person is making a dhikr, he can just make dhikr all the time. And this is why, as I said in the hadith, which I quoted today, in the morning, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was approached by somebody, Ya Rasulallah, يعني ثقلت علي شرائع الإسلام, يعني the regulations and obligations of Islam are so tough for me, and I cannot just keep going, keep counting all of them, keep following all of them. Just tell me about something. فأنبئني بشيء, just tell me of something, يعني أتشبث به. And just tell me of something that I need to just keep stepping to doing so that I'll be saved from the hellfire. So that I'll be closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that I'll be gaining the satisfaction and the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam just told him to just to keep remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To make dhikr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, وَلْيَكُنْ لِسَانُكْ رَطْبًا مِنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Just keep your tongue all the time wet. Of because of the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the very advice that had been given by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to this companion who asked him about how to easily be closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Easy, just remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What does it mean to remember Allah? Are we allowed to forget Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in order to remember Him? To remember Allah means to remember the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means to, you know, to glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To make the istighfar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In any way, you are just mentioning the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You do have Allah in your heart. This is what is meant by to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is again, you know, indicated in the prayer as well. Somebody might say, as we quoted the hadith, or the narrative of Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, when Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas was saying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had made things obligatory upon the followers of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And people might be excused for not doing it, for not doing some of these things. As we said, if somebody is sick and he cannot fast, he's excused and he does not have to fast. This is a kind of obligation, but it has some, you know, conditions for the person to be obliged to do it. Once the person is not meeting these kinds of conditions, khalas, he is exempt from doing it. The zakah, okay, I do not have money to pay the zakah. Khalas, you are exempt from paying the zakah. Only for the will of person is allowed, he is obliged to pay the zakah. So in all kinds of obligations, we do have these kinds of exemptions from these obligations, except the dhikr. You are not exempt in any case to make the dhikr, except if somebody, of course, is insane, somebody is out of his mind. Khalas, yani, he is not required to do any kind of obligation anyway. And he is not to be taken for anything wrong that he is doing. And this is according to what Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas said. Except that dhikr, the person is never exempted from doing the dhikr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah. So what about the prayer? Yani, in fiqh also, the person is never allowed to discard their prayer in whatever way. Even if he is seriously sick, he can pray in whatever way convenient to him. If he is sick, seriously sick, and if he is lying even in bed, he still has to pray. In whatever way. If he cannot move, he can even use his eyebrows just to make the, you know, the different positions of the prayer. Even if he cannot do that, he can even imagine the postures and movements of the prayer. So he is never exempted from making the prayer. So isn't that coming into contradiction to what Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas said? No. Because the salah itself is dhikr. The salah itself is dhikr. When you are praying, you say, Allahu Akbar, and this is dhikr. You can just make dhikr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. When you are making the ruku, you are saying Subhana Rabbi al-Azim. And this is dhikr. You can just say Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim. And when you are making sujood, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. So the prayer itself is defined linguistically as dua. Al-salah lughatan, al-dua. Salah is defined in linguistically or linguistic terms as dua. Prayer, you are making the prayer, supplication to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when it comes to the technical or terminology, terminological definition of the prayer, it is أقوال وأفعال مفتتحة بالتسليم مفتتحة بالتكبير مختتمة بالتسليم. It is just a kind of movements and sayings that you are making, starting with Allahu Akbar and ending with Assalamu Alaikum. So this is the definition of the prayer. So we talked again about the remembrance or dhikr inshallah. We are going to keep going on talking about dhikr inshallah after Fajr inshallah. So coming back again to the angels, they are not, you know, kind of mediator between us and between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are just there in order to run or fulfill the wishes, the orders, the commands given to them by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لا يعصون الله ما أمرهم ويفعلون ما يؤمرون. Regarding the gender or the sex of the angels, as you remember when we were talking about one of the differences between us followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Jews and the Christians, when they were attributing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala certain kinds of human attributes, like for example when they are attributing to Allah son, like the Christians do, and the Jews when they are attributing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the angels as daughters of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So for us Muslims, the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, angels have no sex. They are, you know, they are not males, they are not females. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just saying بَلْ عِبَادٌ مُكْرَمُونَ. They are just very honorable, they are just very revered servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. بَلْ عِبَادٌ مُكْرَمُونَ لَا يَسْبِقُونَهُ بِالْقَوْلِ وَهُمْ بِأَمْرِهِ. Subhanallah, yani they are not doing anything except whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling them to, whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding them. So what the Jews perceive of angels as daughters, as females first, and they are attributing them as the daughters of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we mentioned one time. So this is definitely wrong according to our Islamic creed, according to our Islamic aqeedah. They are not males, they are not females, they are just creatures. They are just there in order to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they do not need to be males or females, because they are not multiplying, they are not marrying, they are not eating, they are not drinking. They are just their superpower. They are just there in order to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They do not need to eat, they do not need to drink, or they do not need to multiply in whatever way. This is the definition of the angels. They are created of light. They are just there in order to fulfill the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in whatever way. When it comes to the number of the angels, it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who knows only about the numbers of the angels. It is not limited. We do not have a very exact number of the angels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are so many, maybe in millions, because they do have different tasks and responsibilities. In some narratives, the Kaaba is just visited daily by more than 17,000 angels. And they are never coming back, just one time. Just, they are just, I don't know whether 17 or 70, 70,000 a day. They're just coming into the Bay al-Kaaba in order to visit, just daily. And they are not coming back. So every day you are receiving 70,000 angels coming to visit al-Bayt al-Haram, al-Kaaba. And they are never coming back. So can you count how many 70,000 they have come to the Kaaba since Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them? So they may be in millions and billions. So the exact number of the angels is known just to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is something that we should not investigate, because it is, you know, the ilm of which is not gonna, you know, add anything to us. So this is just, we have to believe in the presence and the existence of the angels, and that's it. And of course we need to limit our knowledge when it comes to belief in the angels to what we have got from the Quran, what we have got from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they are, as we said, they are not divine. They are not divine. They are not even semi-divine. They are just created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for certain kinds of tasks. And according to what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, they are just doing the tasks that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given them. And they are not dying in the dunya. They are not dying. But on the day of judgment, khalas, when everybody will be just knowing His final destiny was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make all of us to be admitted inshallah to the highest place in paradise, Amir Firdaus al-A'la, inshallah. When everybody will know it's his final destination, khalas, yani there will be no use of the angels, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will just make them to die. So they are just there in the dunya, and they will be on the day of judgment till the believers will be admitted to paradise, and the disbelievers, walayadu billah, will be admitted to the hellfire, and khalas, that's it, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is gonna, even malak al-maut nafsu, even the angel of the death, is gonna die as well, and he's gonna feel the suffering of death, as recorded, or as narrated by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, when it comes to the way they look like, still we cannot imagine how huge the body or the constitution or the construction of the angel is. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam one time, he saw the angel, and one time he was walking and he, you know, just the sun was just blocked, the whole thing was just dark. When the angel was there, you know, it just blocked the whole globe, because it was as huge as to do that. And this is, you know, in another narrative, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained to us the how they look like. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I have been given permission to, you know, to describe the angel, to speak about the angel, or one of them. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, this angel that is carrying the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know the distance between the ear lobes of the angel that's carrying the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of the angels that are carrying the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the distance between the ear lobes and the shoulders of this angel is equivalent or equal to 700 years of journey. 700 years of journey. And this hadith is reported by Imam Abu Dawood. So still we cannot perceive how big angels are. But still, this is according to what we have put from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Just to make it short, because yani, we do not have much time during the month of Ramadan to meet again, and I want to talk inshallah about something else next time. So let me just make it a little bit shorter so as to cover some other articles of faith inshallah today. So when it comes to the tasks that are given to the angels, we wrongly know that the name of the angel of death is Azrael. This is not right. This is a common mistake amongst the Arabs. I guess, I don't know whether it is in Indonesia as well or not. This is not right. This is never right. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never mentioned that. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never said that. But we have some of the tasks that are given to some of the angels, like Sayyidina Israfil, for example. Sayyidina Israfil is the one who is going to blow in the trumpet on the day of judgment. وَنُفِخَ فِي الصُّورِ وَنُفِخَ فِي الصُّورِ. So Sayyidina Israfil is the one who is going to blow on the trumpet on the day of judgment.
Trumpet
is when people will be just coming. You know, it's going to be done twice. When people will be there and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will just them to die and everybody will be just dead after the first time. The second time when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will resurrect all of them, will bring them back, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask him just to blow again and everybody will be resurrected. So this is the thing that we have got to know from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we have another one, which is Mika'il. Mika'il is the one with the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is running, falling down of rain. And this is the one that is directing the winds and the clouds by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bring rain down, to bring water down. And of course, this is something that, you know, people in the desert, you know, appreciate a lot when they get the rain. But this is the thing that they might be surviving the whole year with. So because of the vegetation they do have, the postures for the for the animals, for the cattle they do have. So this is the thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have told us, that Sayyidina Mikael is the one that is taking care of directing the winds and taking care of directing the clouds to bring the rain down on earth. And then we have Sayyidina Jibreel, of course. You know what? Some of the Jewish narratives, they don't like Sayyidina Jibreel, by the way. They never like him. Because he was the one who was just torturing them. He was the one who was just, you know, it is mentioned in the Quran when they were disobeying the prophets and the messengers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was just to blow everything down. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was just vanish them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was just destroying their villages and cities. And it was Sayyidina Jibreel who was taking care of them. That's why they don't like him. And they said, you know, for us Muslims, Sayyidina Jibreel is the mediator between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the prophets and the messengers. And he is the angel of revelation who is taking care of getting the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending it to the prophets and the messengers. And they said it was not Sayyidina Jibreel who was doing that, because this is an honor that they didn't want to give to Sayyidina Jibreel. They said someone else, I guess in some narrative, they are saying Sayyidina Israfil or Sayyidina Mikael. It was not Sayyidina Jibreel. But for us, of course, Sayyidina Jibreel is the one who was taking care of getting down the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and giving it to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the prophets before him. And this is mentioned in the Quran. قُلْ مَنْ كَانَ عَدُوًا لِجِبْرِيلِ. They are the enemies of Sayyidina Jibreel. Why? Because they didn't like him. They don't like, you know, because he, as I mentioned now, he was the one who was just blowing them out. قُلْ مَنْ كَانَ عَدُوًا لِجِبْرِيلَ فَإِنَّهُ نَزَّلَهُ عَلَى قَلْبِكَ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. يعني who, say ya Muhammad, whoever is the enemy of Jibreel, why are they taking this kind of stand against him? He was the one who was just getting you the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَإِنَّهُ نَزَّلَهُ عَلَى قَلْبِكَ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. So we do have some of the tasks that are given to the angels again. As you know, مَا يَلْفِضُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيبٌ عَتِيرٌ. Whatever you are saying. And I think we quoted also this ayah in one of the sessions that you missed, Sheikh Majid in Fajr. مَا يَلْفِضُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ الْكَلْمَةُ الطَّيِّبَةُ. مَا يَلْفِضُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيبٌ عَتِيرٌ. Whatever you are saying is gonna for sure be documented. And you are going to be questioned about it on the day of judgment. مَا يَلْفِضُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ. Whatever a word you are saying, you are uttering. But it is going to be recorded and documented. مَا يَلْفِضُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيبٌ عَتِيرٌ. By the angels, رَقِيب and عَتِيد. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, سَنَكْتُبُ مَا قَالُوا. سَنَكْتُبُ مَا قَالُوا. Allah said, we are going to write down what they are saying, and they will be questioned again about that on the day of judgment. Huh? So angels are the creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that are taking care also of writing or documenting down the whatever people are doing, whatever people are saying, so as to be questioned about these kinds of things on the day of judgment. And then we have the angels that are guarding human beings. We do have this ayah, Surah Al-Kursi. Ayat Al-Kursi. This is the best ayah in the Quran. As Dr. Hussam was saying yesterday, I think Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was saying the best ayah in the Quran is Ayat al-Kursi. And according to so many narratives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said this is the ayah that you need to read day and night so as to get protected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who is going to protect you? The angels. The angels are going to protect you as long as you have read it sincerely to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the intention of being protected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you would read it in the daytime, in the morning, you are going to get protected the whole day. If you read it in the evening, you are going to also get protected the whole night. And this is according to the Hadith of sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you would read it before you want you go to bed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again is going to get you protected by the angels. Or the angels are going to get you protected also from any kinds of, you know, harmful stuff that might come to you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you make wudu before you sleep, if you make wudu, and if you do recite some Quran, including this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask angels to make istighfar for you till you get up in the morning. He will ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive your sins. And of course, they are the angels. Once they are asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for something, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to accept it from them. So these are some of the blessings that we are getting from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just making the angels this huge, these honorable servants to be servants for us as well. They are making istighfar for us, they are protecting us, they are guarding us, they are taking care of, you know, of us, our life going smooth. So these are the angels that have been created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have made them to be as well serving us. So this is the angels. Inshallah, yani, if you don't have any question, we are gonna inshallah deal with these questions in the end. So let us move to another article of faith, which is tu'mina billahi wa malaikatihi wa kutubih. To believe in the scriptures. And I think in the introduction as well, we have hinted to have what does it mean to believe in the scriptures. To believe in the scriptures means that, as we said, we have five scriptures, five holy books revealed to the prophets before Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Quran as well, including the Quran as well. So we have the Psalms that were given to Sayyidina Dawood, وَأَتَيْنَا دَاوُودَ زَبُورًا. And then we do have the sheets of Musa and Ibrahim, Suhuf, Ibrahim and Musa, and then we do have the Torah, we do have the Gospels, and we do have the Quran. One of the articles of faith in Islam is to believe in all these kinds of scriptures. If somebody does not believe in any of them, he is not regarded as a Muslim. Why? Because these scriptures have been sent from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the guidance of human beings. So one of the articles of faith from the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to believe in all these holy scriptures, but with a condition that these holy scriptures, with the exclusion of the Quran, have been subjected to lots of distortions and fabrication and additions and changes. And this is mentioned in the Quran. So the fact that I do have to believe in these holy scriptures is conditioned with the fact that I do have to believe in them with the fact that they have been subjected to distortion. And this is again proved in the Quran when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يُحَرِّفُونَ الْكَلِمَ عَنْ مَوَضِعٍ. They are just distorting, they are changing words from their places. In another place, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَفَتَطْمَعُونَ أَن يُؤْمِنُوا لَكُمْ وَقَدْ كَانَ فَرِيقٌ مِّنْهُمْ يَسْمَعُونَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ يُحَرِّفُونَهُ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا أَقَلُوا. Are you wishing, are you hoping that they are going to listen to you? Are you hoping that they are going to believe in whatever you have got? You believe in whatever you are asking them to? While they have been receiving the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they were changing it, after they have got it, after they have understood it. So this is what some of the proofs that are mentioned in the Quran, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that these holy scriptures have been subjected to lots of distortions and lots of changes. And shortly before the advent of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they had this kind of meeting in Turkey, the priests and the, you know, high elites among the Christians, in order just to decide which books they have to go with in terms of the Gospels. They had 4,000 copies, 4,000 copies of the Gospels. And they didn't know which one was right. And later on, they just agreed on the 4 copies that we do have these days. Only 4 copies that we do have. These 4 copies are the, you know, the production of their, you know, kinds of investigations and the research of 4,000 copies. Can you imagine? 4,000 copies of the Gospels were there, and they just decided that we agreed that we do have only these. So does it not mean that they have lots of things to be added, to be changed, to be taken away from the word that had been given to Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam? And this is again proven in the Quran as the ayah we just mentioned. And they were writing something with their own hands, and they were attributing them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَوَيْلٌ لِلَّذِينَ يَكْتُبُونَ الْكِتَابَ بِأَيْدِيهِمْ ثُمَّ يَقُولُونَ هَذَا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ لِيَشْتَرُوا بِهِ ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا فَوَيْلٌ لَهُمْ مِمَّا كَتَبَتْ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَوَيْلٌ لَهُمْ مِمَّا يَكْسِبُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, who is wail? This is the place, وَلَيَادُ بِاللَّهِ, in the very bottom of the hellfire, وَلَيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. Even the, you know, mountains are going to get melted when it is just to get into this place, وَلَيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. And this is, again, this is not just for those who have documented things or written something and attributed it falsely to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is also prepared for some of the believers, وَلَيَاجُ بِاللَّهِ سَيْدِنَا مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ, who are neglecting the prayer. فويل للمصلين الذين هم عن صلاتهم ساهون. Those who is prepared also for those who are doing the prayer, but those people who are doing it lazy, with laziness, they are not paying that much attention to its time, its due time. فويل للمطففين. Amongst the followers of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, عارفين المطففين, people who are, when they are buying something, they are getting it in fold. But when they are selling it, they are just making it less than the amount they are supposed to be giving to people. These are the people called المطففين. And also they are to be, وَالْعَيَازُ بِاللَّهِ, pushed into the way. So that this is the place where, or that is prepared for those who have written something out of their own, and they are attributing it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَوَيْلُ لِلَّذِينَ يَكْتُبُونَ الْكِتَابَ بِأَيْدِيهِمْ with their hands, and they are attributing it. ثُمَّ يَقُولُونَ هَذَا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ. Why? In order just to get any kind of worldly benefits. So this is the article of faith. This is one of the articles of faith, is that we have to believe in these scriptures, but our belief in the scriptures should be conditioned with the fact that these scriptures have been subjected to lots of distortions, lots of, you know, change, lots of fabrication, and they have falsely or wrongly attributed it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yani, just to make it short again, I think we talked one time when we were addressing the Indonesian brothers and sisters, when we were talking about the Quran, and we said that one of the differences between the Quran and the other scriptures is that the Quran is the holy scripture that is promised by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to get protected till the day of judgment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the ayah, in Surah Al-Hijj, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. And this, we يعني, have some attempts to distort the Quran, but they all went in vain. Why? Because it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who is taking care of protecting the Quran, and it's gonna be protected like that till the day of judgment, inshallah. And this is a challenge. This is a challenge to anybody in the world. If you can just distort it in whatever way, just to go ahead and do it. And I still recall this, I don't know whether I said it here in one time or not, I still recall this thing that I was telling my students in somewhere here in Dallas. They were making the hifz of the Quran. They were memorizing the Quran. In order just to motivate them to memorize the Quran, and they were, you know, they were having hard times because they were not Arabs even. And they were American from, you know, mostly from Afghani background or from Pakistani background, or from Arab background, some of them, but they are born and raised here in America, so their Arabic is not that good. I was telling them, in order to motivate them to keep going memorizing the Quran, what about if we get the whole Mus'haf of the Quran, of the world, all the copies, all the books of the Quran in the world, and just get rid of them, in whatever way, we burn them, we throw them in the ocean, right? And we do the same for the copies that we do have for the angels, for the Gospels, for the Torah. We just need to collect all these kinds of scriptures and they throw them into the ocean. Khalas, finished. We don't have any more copies of the Quran. And we ask each group of people to reproduce the Holy Scripture again. Who is gonna be able to do that? The Christians, right? No? The Jews, no? They can't do that. Only the Muslims. Because the Quran is not in the book. The Quran is in the heart. The Quran is in the mind. And this is a way of protecting the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, can you imagine, when you are saying to someone, okay, alhamdulillah, I have memorized the Quran when I was 10 or 15 or even 20. They don't believe it. How come you memorize this whole thing from A to Z? How come? Somebody told me, if you would give me just 5 pages and ask me to memorize them in 1 year, I won't be able to do that. I will never be able to do that. With, you know, all, I have to be very accurate in the accents and the tajweed and the rulings. I will never be able to do that. I said, this is the miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu, this is the promise. This is the fulfillment of the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. Even people who do not know Arabic, they are memorizing the Quran. Yani we have good example of Brother Yusuf, mashallah. He's a little bit lazy, but inshallah, he's going to, when it comes to memorization, but inshallah, yani hopefully, inshallah, this is a good start for him to keep going, inshallah. So even the Arabs, they can hardly read the Quran, read the Arabic, but still they are memorizing the Quran. And they are getting so angry if you would make a mistake, slight mistake in the Quran, isn't it a way? And mashallah, brother Hidayat, mashallah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him and protect him, mashallah, and all of us. Isn't it a good sign that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is protecting the Quran? Isn't it a good sign that the Quran is really coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who is really taking care of it? Inna subhanallah, inna nahnu nazzalna al-dhikra wa inna lahu lahafizun. Khalas, you feel very comfortable when you recite this ayah. The Quran is never get lost, is never gonna get lost. And this is subhanallah, and the challenge, it is still there till the new judgment. If you can produce as accurate, as eloquent, and the shortest surah of the Quran, go ahead and do it till the new judgment. This is the challenge, this is the real challenge. Subhanallah, yani we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make it easy for us to read and to memorize the Quran, because the Quran is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ahlul Quran hum ahlullahi wa khassatuh. The people of the Quran are the special people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. According to the hadith of sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they are the special people. I don't know what does it mean to be special people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I cannot really perceive what if somebody is just regarded as special to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What kind of blessings he is gonna get? What kind of, you know, kind of special treatment, kind of special, you know, honor that he is gonna get? Really, we cannot perceive it, we cannot understand it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is telling us that people of the Quran are the special people of Allah. Khalas, khalas. Yani you don't need to think about what does it mean to be special to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your sins are forgiven? Yes. Your tawbah is accepted? Yes. You are gonna be amongst the highest, you know, status people in the day of judgment? Definitely yes. You are gonna be on the highest place in paradise? Yes. You can talk about that. You are gonna be special, subhanallah, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How can I get that? Just read the Quran. Make the Quran my companion everywhere. And it's not for you to know that it is protecting you. وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ. Shifa, this is a kind of treatment, physical treatment. Subhanallah, يعني, and rahmah, of course, mercy. يعني, Sheikh Sha'rawi one time was asked about, Ya Sheikh, when you feel, you know, upset or angry or unhappy, why don't you listen to music? Do you listen to music just to relieve yourself, just to feel more comfortable? He said, why should I listen to music? What does it mean to listen to music? Why should I not listen to the Quran? Why should I not read some Quran? This gives me more comfort. Why? Because I'm just contacting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I am talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What else you need to give you comfort than talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Who knows whatever is in your heart? Just say, Ya Allah. Whatever kind of problem you do have, just say, Ya Allah, I have a problem. Khalas. Khalas. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who is running this universe accurately. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who knows whatever is in your heart. But He wants you only to say, Ya Allah, to call Him. That's it. Khalas. So, if you are in a kind of, you know, depression, if you are in a kind, and this is, I'm giving you that, you know, according to my little experience in that, yani, so many people are telling me, yesterday, wallahi, I was talking to somebody in Egypt, and yani, you know, was saying that I felt very depressed, going through some problems, but I read the Quran, khalas, everything is gone, khalas. This is the way we need to deal with the Quran. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again to make the Quran to be our companion. In the dunya, in the grave, it's gonna be, you know, the grave. Yani, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from the darkness and from the, you know, from the loneliness of the grave. How come you know that the Quran is gonna be your companion in the grave and you are not making use of it? It's gonna be your companion. It's gonna be lightening your grave. This is the Quran and you are not making use of it. Yani, are we not scared of the grave? Yani, I don't know, people, whether they are scared or not. But if we are really scared of the grave, khalas, we do have the means to be, mashallah, yani, to be living comfortably in the grave. We will have something to break our loneliness in the grave, which is the Quran. And that's why we are making dua, Allahumma ja'alhu lana fi qabrina nuran, mu'nisan wa nuran. ورفيقا. Make the Quran, Ya Allah, to be our companion, to be the thing that is lightening our grave. Make the Quran to be the thing that is breaking again our, you know, isolation, our loneliness in the grave. This is the dua that we are making in the Taraweeh. And this is the dua that we need to make, inshallah, every time we do have the chance to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again, just to move on, just to make use of time, to antumina billahi wa malaikatihi wa kutubihi wa rusulihi. Okay, this is a big topic again, to believe in this, in the messengers and the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the khutbah, Friday khutbah, I was talking about the very reason for which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had sent messengers and the prophets. Why? You know, initially Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Sayyidina Adam alayhi wa ala nabiyyina afdalus salatu was salam. And then, Sayyidina Adam knew that it was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who created him, and it was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that need to be worshipped alone. Sayyidina Adam was going on the straight path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And some of his followers, some of his, you know, children, disciples. And later on, when people started deviating from the right path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there was a need that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would send messengers and the prophets. Right? And this is out of the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is fair. How come you do not know about something and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to take you for? No. وَمَا كُنَّا مُعَذِّبِينَ حتى نبعث رسولا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, we won't torture people, we wouldn't punish people unless we would send a messenger to them first. Why? لئلا يكون للناس على الله حجة بعد الرسول. So that you will not be having any kind of excuse under your judgment. Ya Allah, I didn't know. No, you knew it. I have sent you such and such a prophet. And you know, the prophets are going to say, Ya Allah, we have conveyed the message to them, but they didn't listen to us. Right? And subhanAllah, yani, this is something which is very beautiful in the followers of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I think I answered this question one time to the sisters. Your wife asked me this question. What does it mean? وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. Wasata. Wasata is a middle, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that we are not extreme in regulations, we are not extreme in whatever thing. Moderation is the thing that we are asked to do, to be sticking to. It is known that on the Day of Judgment, people are going to deny the fact that the messengers and the prophets had already conveyed the message to them. They are scared. They just want to stay away from the punishment. They do not believe in the prophets. The followers of Sayyidina Nuh, or those who were there during the lifetime of Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam, and they did not believe in him, they would be saying, Ya Allah, he did not convey the message to us. We never heard him. The same to Sayyidina Dawood, the same to Sayyidina, you know, Sayyidina Ibrahim, the same to Sayyidina Musa, the same to all these prophets. And these prophets are going to say, Ya Allah, we have already conveyed the message to them. And in this case, and they will ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to go back to refer to ask the followers of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You will be asked about that. You will be asked whether Sayyidina Nuh had conveyed the message or not. You will be asked whether Sayyidina Ibrahim had conveyed the message or not. You will be asked whether Sayyidina Musa or Sayyidina Ismail had conveyed the message or not. How would we know? And we'll say, yes, Ya Allah, he had conveyed the message to them, but they didn't listen. How would we know? We know through the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, through the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala narrated to us these stories of the prophets scattered in so many surahs in the Quran. So starting from Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah Al-A'raf, Surah Hud, Surah Yunus, Surah Ash-Shu'ara. In so many places in the Quran, we do have the stories of the prophets. And of course the Quran, as we just said now, is the very thing that had been given to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with no chain. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that Sayyidina Musa had conveyed the message, this means that Sayyidina Musa had conveyed the message. And this, we have taken this for granted. And you are going to be witnessing for those people. لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ. لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ. And this is mentioned in the last ayah of Surah Al-Hijj. Al-Hajj that we recited yesterday, Surah Al-Hajj, that we recited yesterday. Right? وما جعل عليكم في الدين من حرج ملة أبيكم إبراهيم هو سماكم المسلمين من قبل وفي هذا لتكونوا شهداء على الناس ويكون الرسول عليكم شهيدا. In this way you are gonna witness, you are be the witnesses for the prophets and the messengers on the day of judgment. Meaning that you are gonna be witnessing that the prophets and the messengers on the day of judgment, they have already conveyed the message to their people, but they denied it. خلاص. Even the prophets themselves will be asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to refer to the ummah of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Right? So what kind of aura that we are given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the followers of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So coming back to this question, why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send prophets and the messengers? Just to bring the people back to the right path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every time they would deviate from the right path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah would send a messenger. Allah will send a prophet just to bring them back in order not to have any kind of argument on the day of judgment. Ya Allah, you did not send us a messenger or a prophet. No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent you a messenger and a prophet, but you didn't listen. And do we have to believe in these prophets as human beings? They are not angels. Just human beings, right? And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send human beings? He could have sent angels. But people, again, will be arguing, Ya Allah, these are just angels. And we do not have the same ability of the angel. So how come you are asking us to do something that we cannot do? That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent us human beings. لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has shown His bounty and His grace upon the believers when He subhanahu wa ta'ala had sent to them a messenger from amongst themselves, meaning from their race. لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had been sent from amongst you, مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ. But still, the disbelievers were saying again, وَقَالُوا لَوْلَا أُنزِلَ عَلَيْهِ مَلَكٌ. Yani they said, we wish that we had got an angel, not a human being, as a prophet and a messenger. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْ جَعَلْنَاهُ مَلَكًا لَجَعَلْنَاهُ رَجُلًا وَلَلَبَسْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ مَا يَلْبِسُونَ. It won't make any difference to them. As long as they need just to argue, they are going to argue, even if we'll just send them an angel. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent them prophets and messengers from human beings in order not to say we do not have the same capability of the angels. And later on they also argued with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they said, we wish we would have got an angel as a prophet or a messenger. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, even if we would have sent to them an angel, they would be reacting, they would be, you know, responding in the same way, and they would be confused as well. They would be having the same confusion, they would be having the same argument or reaction, negative reaction. So the belief of the messengers and the prophets means that we have to believe in all of them as human beings, including Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam. Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam also was a human being. He was not God. He was not having, you know, any kind of godly status. No, to be given to him more than any other of the prophets. No, he was a human being. And this is mentioned in so many places in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I think we were talking about this ayah yesterday when we were saying, Brother Ahmed Gabriel asked me yeah, to recite this ayah again. مَنْ مَسِيحَ ابْنُ مَرْيَمَ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُولٌ وَأُمُّهُ صِدِّيقَةٌ كَانَ يَأْكُلَانِ الطَّعَامِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that, as we said now, angels do not eat, angels do not drink. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when talking about Sayyidina Isa, said he and his mom, they were just righteous people. They were just devout to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they were eating ta'am, food. They were eating food. What does it mean? Eating food means that they were human beings, because only, you know, human beings are eating. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just negating any possibility of them being angels. كَانَ يَأْكُلَانِ الطَّعَامِ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when talking about Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam in so many places in the Quran, he subhanahu wa ta'ala is putting more emphasis on the fact that he was a messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a human being. And this is mentioned in a very, very beautiful ayah, very clear ayah, in the end of Surah An-Nisa, in the last rub of it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ يَا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ لَا تَغْلُوا فِي دِينِكُمْ يَا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ لَا تَغْلُوا فِي دِينِكُمْ وَلَا تَقُولُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْحَقِّ إنما المسيح عيسى بن مريم رسول الله وكلمته ألقاها إلى مريم وروح منه. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, يَا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ people of the book, do not exaggerate when it comes to your religion. Don't exaggerate, just be moderate. And do not say but the truth. وَلَا تَقُولُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْحَقِّ إنما المسيح عيسى بن مريم رسول الله. المسيح عيسى ابن مريم just the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وكلمته, and this is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that was given to a Sayyidah Maryam. وكلمته ألقاها إلى مريم. وروح من, and this is out of his spirit. وروح من فآمنوا بالله ورسله ولا تقولوا ثلاثة. And just believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Very clear, right? وآمنوا بالله ورسله, and believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messengers. And do not say three, the Trinity, the concept of Trinity in Christianity. وَلَا تَقُولُوا ثَلَاثَةَ انْتَهُوا خَيْرًا لَكُمْ. You need to stop that, and it is going to be better for you. إِنَّمَا اللَّهُ إِلَهٌ وَاحِدٌ سُبْحَانَهُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just one, the exalted. سُبْحَانَ أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهُ وَلَدٌ. How come? He subhanahu wa ta'ala has a son. لَهُ مَا فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ وَكِيلًا. So this is a very beautiful ayah that's talking about Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam. Some people are confused to the creation of Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam. Sayyidina Isa had been created with a mom, with no father. And he had been created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could create يعني, even with no father, with no mother. They're like Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam. Sayyidina Adam had been created with no father, with no mother at all, right? And say it was not that hard for Allah then to bring somebody from a mother with no father. So why do they attribute Sayyidina Isa to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as his son? This is very wrong, and this is taking them away from the very message of Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, who himself never said that he was the son of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But in all places he said that I am the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is mentioned in Surah Saf. وَإِذْ قَالَ عِيسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمَ يَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ إِنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَيْكُمْ مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيَّ مِنَ التَّوْرَاةِ وَمُبَشِّرًا بِرَسُولٍ يَأْتِي مِنْ بَعْدِ اسْمُهُ أَحْمَدُ. سيدنا عيسى بن مريم رضي الله عليه وعلى نبينا الصلاة والسلام said in this surah, Surah Saf, Surah 61, he said, وَإِذْ قَالَ عِيسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمَ يَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ, O people of Israel, I am the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He never said he was the son of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, I am the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, confirming whatever you have got before me, meaning the Torah, confirming it, I'm not denying it, because it is just a completion. Whatever I'm saying is just a completion to the Torah, and whatever Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was telling us is also a completion to the Torah and the Gospels, right? وَمُبَشِّرًا بِرَسُولٍ يَأْتِي مِنْ بَعْدِ اسْمُهُ أَحْمَدُ. And I am just giving you glad tidings of a prophet to come after me whose name will be Ahmad. وَمُبَشِّرًا بِرَسُولٍ يَأْتِي مِنْ بَعْدِ اسْمُهُ أَحْمَدُ. فَلَمَّا جَاءَهُمْ بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ قَالُوا هَذَا سِحْرٌ مُبِينٌ. When he sallallahu alayhi wa ala nabiyyina wa sallam brought them the signs, the proofs for that, they said it's just, you know, clear magic. قَالُوا هَذَا سِحْرٌ مُبِينٌ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just, you know, ask, فَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ وَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنْ افْتَرَى عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبَ وَهُوَ يُدْعَى إِلَى الْإِسْلَامِ وَاللَّهُ لَا يَهْدِي الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ. So, again, we have to believe in Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam as we do believe in other prophets, namely, or i.e. one of the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to human beings in order to bring them back to the right path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in order to take them away from the darkness of ignorance to the light of belief of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إِنَّ مَثَلَ عِيسَى عِنْدَ اللَّهِ كَمَثَلِ آدَمَ خَلَقَهُ مِنْ تُرَابٍ. He is no different from Sayyidina Adam. Sayyidina Isa is no different from Sayyidina Adam. إِنَّ مَثَلَ عِيسَى عِنْدَ اللَّهِ كَمَثَلِ آدَمَ خَلَقَهُ مِنْ تُرَابٍ ثُمَّ قَالَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. The very example of Sayyidina Isa is the very example of Adam, who had been created from dust. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, be, and he was. ثُمَّ قَالَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. By the order, by the command, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So again, we do believe in all the prophets and the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as human beings who have been sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in order to bring people light of Iman and to take them away from the darkness of ignorance and the disbelief of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I think inshallah we need to stop here inshallah. Whenever we do have another chance, we may be completing the Aqeedah class inshallah. I don't know when, but depending on the schedule inshallah, because Ramadan is going so fast, and as I said in the khutbah, precious days just to go so fast. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our fasting, to accept our dua, and to make us all from those who will be blessed by being admitted to paradise, inshallah. Allahumma ja'al jam'ana hadha jam'an marhuma, wa ja'al tafarruqana min ba'di tafarruq marsuma. Allahumma la taj'al fina wa la baynana wa la minna shafiyan wa la mahruma. Wa salli lahum wa sallim wa barik ala sayyidina Muhammadin al-Nabi al-Ummi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim taslima kathira. Jazakumullahu khair.